Welcome to Castle in this house. This is the HTV. My name is Hemu Sali, and this is Political Science 345. And we are live and online from Castle in this house. This is session 4 in your, for those of you who are taking a class with international politics. And this class is part of the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring semester, we will be broadcasting, I should say we are broadcasting 4 classes. Political Science 335, which is this class, International Politics. And it is offered on Tuesdays from 7 to 9 p.m. The other class is Communications 100, and it's Mass Media and Society. It is offered on Sundays from noon to 1:40, followed by another class in communication, Communications 300, and it's Organizational Communications. This is Saturdays again from 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And finally, on Sundays, there is a Sociology class, the Sociology 315, Sociology of Work, and it's offered from noon to 2 p.m. Sundays, as I said. If you have completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then we start all over again. I don't know if that's it for this session. If you'd like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, visit our website, and it's at www.appliedstudies.tv, or call us on 1-800-1866-278-6789, and the number is there, appears there for you. There is also a number if you have any question. You can call us or any comment or any information you need. We're here to serve everyone. This is, as we said, as I said earlier, this is International Politics 335. And as we know, this is for the students who are taking the class, but also it's open to any general audience. So those of you who have any question about international politics, particularly on our topic today, the topic that is in the news, everybody is watching, and everybody is excited, worried, it all depends which side you are in. We are going to cover in the first part Egypt and what's looking at the revolutionary potential of this revolutionary movement, where is Egypt going, the impact it has had so far, this revolution, this social movement in Egypt, on the region, on U.S. foreign policy, and also we'll deal with the social forces that are behind this. Specifically, we'll try to look at what are some of the root causes that led to this movement, and whether the media that is presenting it as a matter between all the creating the idea that the future could be difficult, could be the major social force, should say, is the Muslim Brotherhood. We'll deal with that issue. We deal with the Muslim Brotherhood. We deal with the role of the military in Egyptian society. We'll also look at the latest development. In the second hour, we're going to shift our focus to the Middle East peace process. Of course, again, with what's happening in today's news, or this week's news, I should say, Egypt. So we'll talk with Dr. Yigal Ernst from USC about Israel and the Middle East peace process. Next week, we'll continue the Middle East peace process, hopefully with another person, another perspective. So let's start with what's happening in Egypt. Well, this week, as we started last week, a lot of things happened in Egypt. And there is today a talk about, the future of Egypt. After 30 years in power, Hosni Mubarak, President Hosni Mubarak, is challenged by his people, and there is a call for his resignation or step down. He has given a speech just a few hours ago in which he talked about initiating new ideas, in other words, keeping up with the promotion of idea for reforms. And he also announced that he will resign after the election. He will not run for elections, and he will resign once the elections are held. And so he's leaving himself until September to run. The reactions from the region, the opposition, for example, in Egypt, and I think this is a really related story, I'll tell you about it. But the opposition, the Egyptian opposition, was not really excited what President Mubarak said. The head of the national coalition, Syed Abdullah, a name that we haven't heard in the media, but it's really known in the Middle East, Nigerian politics, Egyptian politics, and the Middle East. He thought the President Mubarak's speech was depressing. He thought that what Mubarak should have said is lift the state of emergency, the curfew, and he has done a little by way of listening to the voice of reason and the voice of the people. The head of the Rift Party, this is another opposition party, welcomed the step that Mubarak made in terms of allowing, saying he's going to step down, but again, he was very critical of his move, stating that Mubarak should have called for new elections in all levels, and he should basically resign. And the same thing was given, the same reaction was by the Muslim Brotherhood. Muslim Brotherhood, Mohammed Mursi, also called on Hosni Mubarak to resign and to listen to the people's demands and opinion. So from all the reaction that we get from the opposition, this is only at a press, so all the reaction we get from the region is that they think that they believe that Hosni Mubarak should resign, and that what he's doing is only buying time for himself. They would say that it's a done deal. What was actually in some of my classes at the moment, we saw CNN dispatch and Anderson from 360 to Cairo as a sign that this event will be the results that are to be very, very critical to the region. Now, speaking of the region, there has been a lot of talk about the impact of this on the entire Middle East. The first video we are going to show for a few minutes is was on Fox News, and it talks about the impact of this movement, this protest in Egypt, on countries in the Middle East, in particular Jordan, Algeria, and Tunisia. So we'll watch this, and we'll come back. Hopefully, you could send us a question, you could call us or send us a question. So please watch our first video.
Our senior national correspondent John Roberts, who is monitoring events from our London bureau right now. John, clearly this pressure is building daily now on President Mubarak. How is he going to respond?
Building daily on President Mubarak here in Egypt and across the region as well. How Mubarak responds is yet to be seen. We've seen him make some moves to see his cabinet shuffling the deck, if you will. Will he go? That's the question. Let's take a look at the land here. Of course, Egypt is on the center of our map. This is where we've been focused. Completely focused for the rest of the week on events out there. This is Tunisia, here just a little bit to the west, which began all of this last month, of course, down here in Yemen. We've also seen protests to the south of Egypt, in Sudan, and Khartoum. There's been some protests as well. Moving up here into Jordan, where King Abdullah fired his prime minister and dismissed his cabinet because there were protests. since their two opinions of the situation in Northern Israel and the West Bank. Palestinian authorities say they will vote on local council elections as soon as possible here, and then could be the targets of unrest as well. But to give you a little perspective on why people are so worried about this region, let's go more eastward to Iran. Today, they are celebrating the first 10 days leading up to February 11th, which is the 32nd anniversary of the revolution there, the 1979 revolution that swept the Shah from power and installed a religious theocracy, which has been running around with an iron grip ever since. The real worry is that it can happen here in Egypt and go triple A dominoes across the region, so that you would synchronize and slow the fundamentalism right across the northern part of Africa, potentially as well through the Arabian Peninsula. There is the danger of that happening here. However, Egypt scholars that I talked to say there is the possibility for the White House to forestall that by getting on the side of the Egyptian people now. If they continue to throw their law in with Mubarak, there's a chance that fundamentalism may rise out of that. There is some indication, Jonathan, that the White House has been getting that message. I talked to an American official earlier today, said the White House has been telling Hosni Mubarak to recognize the inevitability of his situation here, that he needs to do something about it. However, as the official said, it's unclear at this point whether or not Mubarak fully understands his position. If this goes well, according to Abdul Bayatwan, who is the editor-in-chief of Al-Quds Al-Arabi, who knows a thing or two about Islamic fundamentalism, because he interviewed Osama bin Laden back in 1997, 4 years before the 9/11 terror attack. He says that it's possible for there to be a wave of change across the Arab world. If you get a wave of change, can you be a good one? Here's what he said.
I think definitely it's better than the Middle East. But this is actually worse effect. It isn't a bad one. This is a democratic effect. So if we are calling for communism, Marxism, yes, we have to worry here. If we are calling for a dictatorship, military dictatorship, we should be worried. But if the people are calling for democracy, human rights, the Western values, to be restored in the countries, we should encourage them.
Abdul Bayatwan, he sees no evidence of any kind of momentum toward Islamic fundamentalism in Egypt. He says, however, it all depends on how things go over the next few days. If the army maintains its pledge to fire on the protesters, there could be an orderly transition of power. If they were forced out to go against the protesters, then the whole thing could come apart. According to former chief ambassador David Williamson, who I talked to, what we see here in the next month, maybe even a few months, may not be the final story. That Iran happened in stages, the same thing could happen here in Egypt.
And John, when we talk about Islamists coming to power in Egypt, we're talking in general about the Muslim Brotherhood there. And now, I'm assuming the experts you've spoken to would not say that the Muslim Brotherhood is the same as the Ayatollahs who came to power in Iran in 1979.
Not in any way, shape, or form the same as the Ayatollahs came to power in 1979. That's absolutely correct. However, it is a movement that has given rise to extremism. Hamas, and Kurds of Al-Qaeda were also born out of the Muslim Brotherhood. And while there is this idea that they are a moderate Islamic organization, Islamist organization right now, it is possible that given the right circumstances for the people that I've talked to, that rise to Islamic fundamentalism could happen depending on how things go over the next few days or weeks.
And so, listening to an Egyptian-born writer and scholar last night who made the interesting point that we shouldn't necessarily think this is an either-or, the Democratic opposition movement, perhaps led by Mohammed el-Baradei, or the Muslim Brotherhood. There is the possibility, handled correctly by the U.S. and other nations, that there could be some opposite of those two, and that might be, in effect, the best way forward, and the best possible outcome from the United States, too.
Yes, a sort of coalition that involves a number of different factions, potentially led by el-Baradei, but here's the caution that David Wormser told me about a little bit earlier on today. If el-Baradei were to be appointed as the leader of some sort of interim government, does he have the strength to deal with the Muslim Brotherhood, or maybe the Muslim Brotherhood, or other factions within the government who have their own agenda sort of trampled, if you will, or use el-Baradei as a bit of a trampoline to achieve their aims? This is why this idea of this happening in stages be so important. Luckily, what we see in the next days or 48 weeks will be the final outcome of what happens in Egypt. There are a number of different levels to go through at any point during that transition as well. Things can take a turn around that idea.
All right, John Roberts, we'll see you next time. We'll see you in London. Thanks very much.
Welcome back to Pastor Dominguez Bells. This is Podcast 35, International Politics. And we are what's happening in Egypt, or the attack in Egypt on Fox News, where they talked about this, what is now labeled as the Downing Street effect, meaning that there was a revolution that started in Tunisia, it spread to Egypt, and then the prediction there is going to somewhere else. Several newspapers are reporting that there are demonstrations in the other part of the Middle East, including Yemen. Yemen, there is a demonstration scheduled for February the 3rd. North East Syria also, there has been a lot of demonstrations planning, and although it hasn't had the big impact that we've seen in Egypt, but also there are plans of demonstration. Sudan is the same thing. In Algeria, there is talk about, or already on Facebook and some internet outlets are calling for mass demonstrations in Algiers on February the 12th. And in Morocco, there was some demonstration this morning, and there are others planned, where the call is for, in Morocco, is for the king to go. There are also some people that are talking about implication in Pakistan as far as China. China, as we know, has taken the decision to control the internet more than what it used to. As we know, China hired Google to do its censorship, which is a very tricky way of doing it, and a smart way also. They pay someone to censor things for them, and what a better source than Google. So there, too, they are concerned by the effect of what's happening in Egypt. So there is this, what we call this dominance effect. What's very interesting is, and we are going to look at this in a few minutes when we look at the root causes. What's very interesting is that there has been so much emphasis on the Muslim Brotherhood. Is that a real effect? What I'd like to suggest, and I'll expand on this later, that really in today's demonstrations and this report that we see, we've seen this is not about Muslim fundamentalists or the Muslim Brotherhood or any kind of religious movement. This is a mass movement, intellectual and middle class, and we'll come back to it in detail. So it is the presentation that this is a Muslim Brotherhood, and we need to be concerned about Islamists. The second thing that we got from the presentation by John Roberts is the idea that United States should somehow be, or United States has a role in this. And we look at how President Barack Obama responded to the latest speech by Hosni Mubarak. But before that, let's look at some things that are happening in the region and with this video on Jordan, where the King Abdullah today took the decision to fire his prime minister and appointed a new one, all in line with what's happening, or feeling what's happening in Egypt and also what happened in Tunisia. The point in all of this, in this second video, what I'd like you to take, is the idea that the leaders of the region are taking notes. And do you see that this is going where do you see this is going? Perhaps what we should be looking at is this revolution going to stop in Egypt, if it is a revolution, or is it, going to go in other places? Please call us, and let's watch the next video on Jordan.
Political change in Egypt is spilling over now to Jordan. Now, just hours ago, King Abdullah fired his government and appointed a new prime minister with orders to start political reform. Before a fierce post-politician party, she's joining us from the State Department. This is an extraordinary situation, as you know, because it's a domino effect here. We are seeing the pieces fall one by one. What do we see? I mean, it almost looks like a preemptive move to prevent something like what we're seeing on the streets in Egypt.
in Jordan, you'd have to say that. In fact, they did have demonstrations, not obviously as big as they had in Egypt, but they have had demonstrations in Jordan. And the target of those demonstrations was, in fact, was the prime minister, who has been dismissed. And the U.S., behind the scenes, has been urging political change for some time. But this is really, you would have to say, a preemptive move by King Abdullah II to bring in some possibility of reform. The people want it. You just have to look around the neighborhood, and he can see what is going on in other countries. Now, to be fair, the king is a much more popular person in his country than Mubarak, President Mubarak, is in Egypt. That said, there is this this movement and feeling and atmosphere in the Mideast that's rapidly swelling.
And Jill, tell us about the region as a whole. We've traveled there. We've seen much of that in the Middle East region and the areas of those countries. They are different in many ways, but they're also very similar. Do we expect that there will be other countries that will follow suit?
Well, we've had the demonstrations, and just go back, looking at Tunisia, which was really kind of this whole movement. That was the first. Now you have Egypt, which is huge. You have Jordan. Then you also have other countries. You had some demonstrations in Algeria, in Yemen. And all of these countries are very different, but there are some certain things that are in common to all of them. Number one, you have to say large numbers of very young people, very young populations, people who, in some cases, are educated. For instance, in Egypt, according to one U.S. official, there is the largest number of unemployed college graduates in the world in Egypt. So think of the pent-up frustration on that. So young people, economies that don't let them in, there are no jobs, it's very hard for them to succeed. And also, great disparities in wealth. These countries have a lot of rich people and a lot of poor people. So those are some of the general factors that are leading to these demonstrations.
We'll come back to Castelli Media's House. This is Political Sensitive 35, International Politics. And we have just watched a video on what's happening in Jordan, where the King Abdullah called on a dismissed his, what is apparently, unpopular prime minister, replaced him with somebody else who is going to pursue some political reforms. We don't know where is that going, but King Abdullah has been having problems in Jordan, and there have been demonstrations a long time before this move, but King Abdullah has been resisting pressure of not firing his prime minister until today. Certainly, what's happening in Egypt and what happened in Tunisia, or continued to happen in Tunisia, had a big impact on this. A couple of things that you could get from this video that I'd like to highlight. One point that the CNN reported, the region is seeing a dominance effect, and we've seen this in the previous video. Then the point that was made by the guest on the program, we have to check that name, the name of that person, but it's not important. But her answer to sort of her comments on what all these things are happening, there are some commonalities. She talked about that most of the protests, those who are protesting, are very young people, educated. The second thing is the economy don't let them in, meaning that they don't have any jobs. And the third reason she talks about the disparity of wealth. What's really, really interesting when we look at the case of Tunisia and Egypt, there is another variable that is common, that both of these countries have actually seen economic growth. And if you do, those of you who have studied, especially the students, and have looked at some of the theories of comparative politics, if you haven't, this is a chance to take my political change class. Good way of putting it in here. The idea, if you, in comparative politics, there is this theory that Henson and Huntington brought in the 80s, when he looked at the speed of economic growth when a country is developing very, very fast, but the system remains democratic. And his hypothesis is that if you have rapid economic growth, but you don't have political institutionalization, meaning political democracy or political openness, who are likely to have a revolution. And we usually apply this, or those the optimists who thought that Clinton was correct, they look at Iran from 73 to 79, where Iran experienced huge economic growth, but it did not, the Shah of the time, the ruler of the time, continue to rule with an iron fist. There was no democratization. Iran, as we know, during that time became the sixth military power in the world, but the economically it did very well. It was doing very well, but politically it remained a close. And following this proposition, Hendricks' proposition, it is because of that gap between growth, economic growth, and democracy that you had a revolution in Iran. So the optimists point to this case by saying Hendricks is correct. But other people who have found problems with our theory, we will get to it another time. The point is related to what's happening in Tunisia and Egypt. When you look at the economic indicator, and I urge students to do this, to look at, to do more in-depth analysis of socioeconomic conditions, the socioeconomic variables, we see that both Tunisia and Egypt have seen good economic growth in recent years. In fact, the prediction that GDP, GDP per capita for next year are very, very, very good for both countries, or at least if it is happening. You see this economic growth going solidly, but the system remains closed. And people were saying that one of the root causes is that those who were getting educated, those who were sort of benefiting from the system economically, wanted also to see the system politically open, but it never opened. And that's one thing that led to that. But in a lot of cases, Egypt, like in other parts of the Arab world, really, Egypt was always expected to see this kind of environment, mainly because the conditions were always terrible. And Egypt's position, we'll talk about this later on with Dr. Ernst, Egypt's position on the Middle East peace process has been very, very questionable. And the Egyptians, to a large degree, were sort of not happy with the position on the Gaza issue, the Gaza blockade, the Gaza war. So there has been so many issues there that were sort of very, very disturbing. Plus the disparities that the report talked about, the gap widening between the rich and the poor. And what's interesting about it is that Egypt is not the only case, as we talked about this before. The Arab world is really wealthy, especially the countries Algeria Algeria, you could only, other countries in Northern Africa have done, and, you know, they have very very solid infrastructure. Morocco, these are countries that have a lot of wealth, and yet has not been given back to the people. In other words, has not generated any economic development. Literally, it sounds comment. Thank you so much, Sam, for your observation. And you say, I want to see a country get what they vote for. Democracy means they choose, not like the reaction of the Palestinian election of Hamas, where the U.S. said we voted wrong and we're not very fair. This is a very, very, very important point. I just remind our viewers to call us with any comment. But Sam's continue also. The rich here in the U.S., they say there is a recovery, but as in other countries, the problem is the Sam Huntington was a believer in the great game of Makanda and Hoshoff. That's a good read, I think, is it Sam? It's a good read, and thanks for the comment. Let's stay with the United States. When we come back to Huntington, I'm glad you guys are following this. This is excellent. It's really, for those of you who are looking for a paper, try to focus on testing some of the propositions. and test the case of Tunisia and Egypt. I think this is a good time to look at it and to do some in-depth work. And there is no other way, better way than stepping in front of us. And a little bit of research, you can understand what's happening and make sense, perhaps give us a good analysis of what's happening. Of course, the events are going very, very fast, but nevertheless, it's worth examining, particularly when we look at the root causes of why we have what we have. And we are going to come back to some of the issues, root causes later on in the semester, if not today. The other video that I'd like to show you before we look at the issue of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egypt is the United States reaction. And I think it fits very well with what Sam commented or made reference to. The United States has been in a very, very difficult position. The position is that they don't want to appear to support the reformists because the demonstrators or those who are revolting or the revolution, if you want. They don't want to appear as if they are in support of what's happening on the ground, the people revolting against President Hosni Mubarak, because they really don't know or they're afraid of the insurgents. They don't know what's going to happen. At the same time, they have their long friend, Hosni Mubarak, has done everything to please them in recent years. And for 30 years, Mubarak has been someone who worked very, very, who worked very closely with the United States. He guaranteed the security with Israel. He proved to be a strong ally, a strong, if you want to use Scottish terminology, partner of peace with the Israelis. And in fact, on several occasions, he's done the job of making Israel actually look better. Specifically, in the war on Gaza in 2008, it was President Hosni Mubarak who refused to let the caravans of food going inside Gaza. He was the one who did not let those caravans and those food products to go to Gaza because Israel at the time was attacking Gaza, and it was a tragedy in the Middle East. The war in Gaza created made Israel look terrible, but so was Egypt, because Egypt was playing, was being the puppet perceived in the East of Israel. So, from that perspective, Hosni Mubarak delivered was very, it proved to be a strong partner with the Israelis and the United States. So it didn't make sense for the United States to come and get rid of him now. But he's liable, he proves to be a damaged good, if you want. And from that view, United States tried to play in both hands. And the video that I want to show you later, you'll see what President Barack Obama's reaction. So the United States tried to play on both hands. To a degree where today we've seen some things happening. And before we go that, so what I want you to do is to watch the reaction of President Obama and then tell me what you think. Should the United States be more forceful and come straight forward and say, I say you're out, you know, let's work with the other person. It's best for the United States to remain outside and just watch what's happening. So what role the United States should play in this Egyptian crisis? Let's watch the video and we'll come back. I'd like to hear your opinion and also talk to you about how you view the situation.
I'm very patient. We've seen enormous demonstrations by the Egyptian people for months from the beginning of the Indian chapter in the history of the Americans, the hunting of the United States. And we have demonstrations being in close contact with our Egyptian counterparts, a broad range of the Egyptian people, as well as others across the region, and across the world. In fact, we start for a set of core principles. First, we get close balance. We have the Egyptian military for the professionalism and patriotism that it has shown thus far carrying along peaceful protests while protecting indigenous people. We've seen tanks, armored cars, and soldiers and protesters increasing in the streets. Going forward, I urge the military to continue its efforts to ensure this type of change is peaceful. Second, we stand for universal values, including the rights of indigenous people to freedom of assembly, freedom of speech, and the freedom to access information. And so we've seen the incredible potential for technology to empower citizens and the dignity of those who stand up for a better future. And going forward, the United States will continue to stand up for democracy and the universal rights that all human beings deserve in Egypt and around the world. Third, we have spoken out on behalf of the need for change. After a speech today, I spoke directly to President Obama. He recognizes that the status quo is not sustainable and that change must take place. The activists who are privileged to serve in positions of political power do so at the will of our people. Through thousands of years, Egypt is now leading on this transformation. The voices of the Egyptian people tell us that this is one of those moments. This is one of those times. Now, it is not the role of any other country to determine Egypt's leaders. Only the Egyptian people can do that. Yes, from the dedicated time to President Obama, it's my belief that an orderly transition must be meaningful. It must be peaceful. And it must begin now. Furthermore, the process must include a broad spectrum of Egyptian voices and opposition leaders. It should lead to elections that are free and fair. And it should result in a government that's not only grounded in democratic principles, but is also responsive to the aspirations of the Egyptian people. Through this process, the United States will continue to stand in the hand of partnership and friendship to Egypt. We stand ready to provide any assistance that's necessary to help the Egyptian people as they manage the aftermath of these protests. The last few days, the passion and the pain that has been demonstrated by the people of Egypt has been an inspiration to people around the world, including here in the United States, and to all those who believe in the inevitability of human freedom. The people of Egypt, particularly the young people of Egypt, I want to be clear. We hear your voices. I have an unyielding belief that you will determine your own destiny. And seize the promise of a better future for your children and your grandchildren. And I say that as someone who is committed to a partnership between the United States and Egypt, there will be difficult days ahead. Many questions about Egypt's future will remain unanswered. But I am confident that the people of Egypt will find those answers. That truth can be seen in the sense of community, in the streets, can be seen.
Welcome back to Castle Dominguez Hills. This is Political Science Day 35, and we have just been watching President Barack Obama's response to President Hosni Mubarak of Egypt, who announced that he is going to stay in power until the elections, that he would step down and not run for re-election. This move, as we've seen in the Arabic press, was not well welcomed. It was seen as something that is really half-measured, and they wanted Hosni Mubarak to take a step further. In the United States, from what we've seen is that the United States seems to continue to work, wanted to work with President Hosni Mubarak. In fact, a statement by John Kerry, the chair of the Senate Foreign Relations in the Senate, is very clear. John Kerry wants Hosni Mubarak now to work with civil society to ensure that the transition to what he calls democracy or elections will go smoother, with no problems. But it's really that's not the image, it's the facts, the trauma, the problems that Hosni Mubarak is facing. good job for our people back there. So it's a very, very, very interesting development from the United States. The other thing that's really interesting about the speech of Obama, that Obama made, he then is as the need for the military to continue to work, to do what it's been doing. He talked about how the military has handled it very well, and that he wanted them to continue doing what they're doing. That's number one. Number two, he stressed also the idea of continuing of the United States, always promote universal values, and he talks about freedom of press and so on and so on and the like. And then he talks about the need for change, that the change is imminent in the Middle East, and so on and so forth. These are the three points, but what's really important to us, as probably watching what's happening, is number one, the military. The military has been sort of behaving. But one wonders, if you, those of you who are interested in this issue, to look at the role of the Egyptian military in Egypt's society. Don't forget that it is this military, the same social force, whether we're making it look as very nice and all those wonderful stuff that we hear about, it's this military that keeps President Mubarak in power. So we should not be forgetting that. The other thing is that when you look at the demonstration, and the Social Times had a very, very good picture yesterday on the front page, if you missed it, please go and look at it, particularly those of your students, when you see a bunch of tanks in the street and then a lot of people in the area. Or the other most important pictures that you see, or the most visible picture that you see, Egyptians on the tanks. Now, logically speaking, realistically speaking, you cannot shoot the people, because if you are going to shoot them, you are going to create a huge massacre and the world will be against you. So from a practical point of view, the military is not attacking, that's actually a picture that's not reflecting my point. But we'll find you one. From a practical perspective, the military could not shoot the people. So, yes, the question is this the military is doing it because it lacks the people, and it actually has been a good social force, and it has been a promoter of whatever you say in Egyptian society? Or is it doing it because of pragmatic reasons? So, as a political analysis, someone who's looking at this, we have to be really, not to be taken by this idea that this is a nice military, they are not shooting people. No, they are not shooting people because, frankly, they can do it. The military is one of the most important, also wealthiest, the generals, wealthiest people in Egypt. So when you talk about distribution of wealth, when you go and look at it, it's also the military people that are benefiting from it. So you have to think about that very carefully. Staying for universal values, democracy, and so on and so forth, I urge you to go and look at the article today on the Social Times about the United States position on this issue. Today, the United States, in the state, in the article, it is stated that the United States doesn't mind having the Muslim Brotherhood group in the next, as part of the dialogue and part of the future Egypt. And namely, they are not going to oppose the presence of the Muslim Brotherhood in the political structure, which is a very, very interesting, big change from the previous position, particularly in, as far as 2005, when George W. Bush was in power, where the American policy, American administration, continued to push and to talk about reforms and so on and so forth. We mentioned this last week, or every 6 months, when the Egyptian officials come to visit to eat Washington as required by the treaty they have in 1979 with the Camp David Treaty. Every time, every 6 months, they have strong criticism of the American administration of Osama Bin Laden regime. There has been criticism of the reports of religious freedom on the Coptic minority. All of these are well documented, you can see them. But all of this criticism were really always sort of not taken seriously. At the back of this was the issue of the Muslim Brotherhood. What do you do? If you were going to initiate reform, can you actually engage in genuine reforms in the Middle East? particularly in 2005, without the inclusion of Muslim Islamist organization, the United States was against that. We all remember what happened in the Palestinian case, where the United States gave the green light to the Palestinian National Authority to have elections. But then the winner turns out to be Hamas, and then the United States says, wait a minute, we don't want this political organization in power. So the point in all of this is that prior to this, to today's, or yesterday's position of this American administration, the United States talked about political reform, urged the Arab leaders, including Egypt, and particularly Egypt, to issue political reforms, but they have never addressed the issue of Muslim Brotherhood as far as Egypt is concerned. So this latest move is sort of qualitative change, and it sends a strong signal for the people in Egypt, civil society in particular, that, you know, you could begin engaging in a dialogue that would include Islamist fundamentalists. And so it's very, very interesting from that development is very, very interesting. Let me take this duration. Lily, thank you so much for the comment, and good work on class, good comments. You're smart. Lily, why does the United States blindly support Israel? What kind of information does Israel have that the U.S. doesn't want to get out? You know, I'm going to hold on to this question when our guest, Dr. Yigal Arens, will join us. And, you know, we could always ask him. He's the man to answer all those questions. Okay. So, and for those of you who are watching, and don't forget to send us a note or call us. You know, it's also okay to call. This is a class, program for a class, International Politics 335. But if you happen to be a general audience, we also want you to comment on these issues. We welcome you, so please call us. Now, just to get back a little bit to what we were talking about, the United States position on the Muslim Brotherhood, and just there is a video that I think it's best to watch next time. But the point here is that when you look at the way this situation, this crisis in Egypt has been framed, it has been framed as a crisis that could be potentially damaging to American national interests in Israel. Namely, they are presented as one of the guests said earlier in the videos, at either or, it's either Mubarak or the Muslim fundamentalist. Well, you really, if you look at it from that perspective, yes, you could say, you know, it's Muslim fundamentalist. But I think that thinking is really in the 80s or the 90s. And what we've seen in recent year in Egyptian politics, particularly since we're talking about it, is the decline of the role of the Muslim Brotherhood in Egyptian politics. If you measure it by the members in the parliament, in 2005 they had about, I believe, 19 seats. They ran as independent for the parliament. They've been part of the political process. They are banned, but they have been able to run under other political umbrellas, sometimes these socialist forces. But anyway, they run as independent and people know who they are. This is not, strange to people, so people vote for them. They got about 20 seats. I have to check the information on this and get back to you. But this is the point. In 2005 election, they get that many points. Last November elections, they got no seats. Now, there has been so much talk about the last 2 years parliamentary elections, and they all are right. All political analysis are correct, or perhaps they're not. But the point is that there has been accusation that those elections were rigged, that they were frauds, and so on and so forth. But here's the point that we need to look at. The Islamist fundamentalist brotherhood candidate won nothing. But you haven't seen any kind of major demonstration in Egyptian politics in the streets or anywhere else, which suggests that their strength is not as used to be. The point I'm trying to say is that, yes, the Islamist fundamentalist Muslim Brotherhood and other Islamist organizations were very strong in the 70s, 80s, but in recent years, their power has been declined. For several reasons. One is the fact that they're being really persecuted. And after 9/11, it has been tough for the Islamists because the leaders of the Middle East have been used terrorism to abuse human rights, and we all know this. It's that well documented. And the Muslim fundamentalist groups have been one of the people that were affected. So leadership crisis, you know, harassment by the government, all of this have had their toll on their membership. The same thing is that the Middle East, because the social forces have changed. And you have more liberal organizations, the moderates, the educated, the secular, the presence of, you know, the Facebook, all these technological variables are having an impact on the youth and so on and so forth. And they are tend to prefer middle of the road positions than extremes like those that have the Muslim Brotherhood. The point, to get back to it, is that to present the crisis in Egypt as that between, you know, or the choices are between Muslim fundamentalists or Hosni Mubarak is very misleading. It ignores the fact that there has been a lot of changes in Middle Eastern society, and in particular in Egypt. I'm going to read Christopher's note, and after that we'll take a break. So Christopher, thank you for your email. We have been hearing rumors that what is happening in Egypt is caused by Iran. What do you feel about this? I also heard rumors that the United States planned this. You could actually do WikiLeaks and the Egypt crisis, and you can get it. There are some kind of report that saying it has been planning this regime change in Egypt for the last 2 years. I really don't know. What I know is that at this condition, the conditions and the socioeconomic conditions are really there for a revolution of the magnitude that we have seen in Egypt. So, Christopher, it's a matter of how you take it. What I strongly urge you is go for evidence. Find evidence and write a paper on it. And, you know, maybe that's actually it's a good thing to do. Let's take a break, because when we come back, we'll continue this discussion, but from a different angle. Our guest, Dr. Evil Arons, is here, and we'd love to welcome him when we come back. Let's come back in 10 minutes. Thanks.
You're watching VHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
At the halfway mark of the season, you know, we're at top of the conference. We know we have to go to the conference one more time. And it's always hard with the second team. You have to play people, especially when you beat them. And sometimes you have some folks that they just destroy and the loss is on it. Most teams are going to be really looking forward to doing this because we're going to first time. In addition to our ranking, we're sure there's an international information program on the top of the conference. Every year is going to be a battle, and most of the court. Also, our long-term goals, you know, we're excited to have the host region. I don't think there's ever been a year in the host region. We're in the region of the human flag on the region. So, that's ever been done. And I'm trying to see if there was good leadership. And that's ultimately our goal. But this is a long game of time. We really want you guys to join us.
I'm going to go to the next one. Workshops and focus the office first to local elementary schools. We do that every year. The idea is that we are not doing theater so much as entertainment, doing theater to help make our lives better. It is community service first and theater second. So, for instance, after we do a play reading of a play called Submitting into the American Culture of Urban Asian Immigrants. And that makes social issues. It has more of a direct purpose for society.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be learned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
This is our book because I'm currently in the office. It's from an outside teacher. It's written here. I took last month to be out for some conversation, and I actually didn't like it. I didn't study, and I actually do a category in a current level.
I took one of the distance learning classes recently for convenience. It was nice to be at home in the mornings and watch it at home, or if it didn't work out that way, I could tape it and watch it at my own leisure. Well, I took this learning course because it's been able to watch videos anytime I want at my convenience, and it's easy to do that. I can watch it at home or either at the media center, and
I would recommend this to a friend.
On this job, safety is our first concern. There's a lot that could go wrong. Unfortunately, we have Cal State Dominguez Hills, the only authorized OSHA training center in the Los Angeles area. If you're in need of OSHA certification, or if safety is one of your concerns, call 888-4LA-OSHA and learn how to be safe. Remember, safety comes first.
Unveiling of the CSUDH All-America Wall of Honor. In this very room, we have athletic All-Americans, academic All-Americans, and World Scholar Fighters.
The number of you in the room tonight are those scholar athletes who have been part of the history here.
And I want to welcome and thank you for coming to celebrate this historic occasion at CSU Dominguez Hills. It's a thrill to have all of you back on campus.
1, 2, 3, 4. Program service of Colorado State University Media Services.
Welcome back to Casa Dominguez Hills. This is International Politics 355. And this class is part of the Applied Studies Master's Degree Program, Completion Program. Classes are broadcast live on the this cable television channel and webcast on the internet each week. This spring, we are broadcasting 4 classes. This class is number 1. It's offered every Tuesdays from 7 to 9. It's called Semester 35. The other class is Communications 100. It's Mass Media and Society. It is offered on Saturdays from noon to 1:40. Also another class in Communications, Communication 300, and it is Organizational Communications on Saturdays at the same day, just after the other class, 1:50 to 3:30 p.m. And finally on Sundays, Sociology is 3:15, Sociology of Work, and it's from noon to 2 p.m. If you have completed the first 2 years of college, you could earn your bachelor's degree by enrolling in these classes. All of the courses you need to complete your bachelor's degree will be broadcast on this channel during the next 2 years, and then we'll start all over again. If you would like more information about the Applied Studies Bachelor's Degree Completion Program, please visit our website, and we have it there on the screen. It's www.appliedstudies.tv, or call us at 1-866-278-6789. And now we'll come back to today's program, and as I promised, the second half of this class is the best, and with me, I'm honored to have Dr. Yigal Ahrens, who is the Deputy Director of USC's Information Sciences Institute. Dr. Ahrens received his PhD from the University of California at Berkeley. He's also the Director of the Digital Division of the University of Southern California's Information Science Institute.
Director of the Intelligence Systems Division at USC and the Digital Government Research Center.
I'm glad you're here. This is the second time I remember when we did the old days in Middle East politics. This is international politics.
And let's start the Middle East as part of it.
And we're actually holding that point earlier. Okay. Let's start where we start, where we're finished earlier, Egypt. Egypt apparently is creating a lot of impact in the region. Israel is very concerned. What is the concern that Israel is raising at this point?
Well, it's the official Israeli position has been very cautious. Officially, they haven't been saying much. In fact, the Prime Minister of Palau has been reported to have instructed all cabinet members not to say anything about Egypt. But unofficial reports say that they would like Mubarak to continue in power. In fact, there was a report in the Israeli press, that the foreign ministry has instructed ambassadors throughout the Western world and also from China to tell government officials in those countries to back Mubarak.
Mm-hmm. Let's go back to that view. Is the view in Israel, the only official position, what Israel's Arabs, the Majid, the peace now, how are they looking at these changes? What's happening in Egypt, I should say?
Everybody has a happier view, right? Is sympathy mixed with concern. It's hard not to be sympathetic to a population that's rising against a dictator. It's not, I guess it's not the worst dictator in the world. There are countries that are under worse rule, but still a regime that involves in torture, suppression of democratic speech, and the ability to run for parliament and so forth. So people naturally have sympathy. People in Israel, both on the official level and, from what I understand, many in the population in general, are concerned with the stability of the area. Right? They've complained about the fact that the peace with Egypt was what they call a cold peace. Right? The state and the population have not been very sympathetic towards Israel. There maybe good reasons for that. Nevertheless, there has been no armed conflict, and the terms of the 1979 peace accord have been strictly adhered to. Egypt has collaborated with Israel on a variety of policies that Israel has, and people are concerned with what will happen if things fall apart.
There is a video clip. This is a video clip, and it's about how Israel, particularly I think the examples you gave us about Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, he comes straightforward and talk about what's happening in Egypt. We're going to watch it for, it's I think about 3 minutes. When we come back, we'll talk more about what's happening in Egypt, and more specifically what's happening in Israel and the Middle East peace process. Everybody is talking.
The images and the tips of the story, along the leadership here, there's real concern. Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu meeting with the German leader Angela Merkel in Jerusalem made his strongest comments on Nancy Egypt to date.
What could develop, which already happened in several countries, including Iran, are oppressive regimes of extreme Islam. That is my fear.
He added that he hoped Israel's long-standing peace treaty with Egypt would survive. That peace was made in 1979. The American President Jimmy Carter bringing together Israel and Egypt to sign a historic deal. Over 30 years later, the leaders are different. But President Mubarak is the closest thing Israel has to a friend in the Arab world. He's a key mediator during Middle East peace talks with the Palestinians. What he's given Israel is stability. But across Egypt, that has evaporated in a matter of days. And Israel is worried about what comes next.
This is very, very definitely bad. In a world in which we are already facing Hezbollah and Lebanon, Hamas in Gaza, and the prospect of, God forbid, what are the fundamentalist Islamic organization taking over in Egypt is obviously not something we can ignore.
In the uprising in Egypt, the Muslim Brotherhood he's referring to has so far taken a back seat. But if there are new elections, the movement could end up doing well. Israel's plan of its own democracy. It might not be so keen on what democracy can deliver in Egypt.
Considering Mubarak's rule has meant that for three decades, Israel has not really had to worry about its most powerful neighbor. But with Egypt's political future in the balance, Israeli eyes are now anxiously looking south. John Dobson, BBC News, Jerusalem.
Welcome back to International Politics 365, and we are doing this house live on live. This is a program that is for students but also general audience. Feel free to call us on the subject. We are discussing Israel, Egypt, and the recent development. With me and the students, Dr. Yigal Arens. And Dr. Arens, I want to ask you about the video that we just saw. Israel has some concerns. We talked about them earlier. Are they legitimate concerns? Do you see anything else you want to add after watching the video?
Well, the concerns are reasonable. Yeah. I mean, there has been, because Egypt was removed from the sort of countries that could conceivably be at war with Israel, that's, you know, allowed the state of Israel to. But it also made it much less likely that any other country would enter a war, initiate war with Israel. That's obviously something that Israeli leaders like. But I think there is another element that you don't hear Israeli leaders talk about, and you didn't hear about it in the video, is that the Israelis realize that the population in general in Arab countries around them is sympathetic to Palestinians. I think that's quite understandable. They see the suffering of these people who, you know, many have family relations with, or certainly have a sense of kinship because of culture. And Israel has been able to ignore that because we've had deals with these autocratic leaders who had other reasons for being supportive of Israel. In the case of Egypt, that was, you know, a lot of military aid that came from the U.S. as part of the peace agreement in 1979, and other kinds of support for the Mubarak regime, even now, right? We see the U.S. is not backing away, certainly not talking about democracy in Egypt, but they talked about democracy in Iran when there was a student kind of rebellion or demonstrations after the elections there. So Israel was able to ignore the sympathy that the population in general had for Palestinians, and therefore it is fearful of true democracy in Egypt because it is clear to them that a government that represented the people would not be as friendly to Israel when Palestinians were concerned.
Mona Lisa, thanks Mona for the good work in class and also the question. Mona Lisa asks, did Israel wait too long to negotiate with the Palestinian Authority now that Hamas may be emboldened with the changes in Egypt?
That's a long question. Right. The Israelis clearly have a sense that time is on their side. There's no need to hurry. If there are those who intentionally would like to drag out negotiations with Palestinians forever, this actually, if when we talk about the Palestine Papers, this is already admitted by United Security in one of the discussions there, because they feel that they will gain, get a better hold on the occupied territories, and they have nothing to lose. Well, it turns out that may not be true. Things can change. They have relied on the Egyptians to help them blockade the Gaza Strip. Borders Israel and borders the sea, which is controlled by Israel, and also borders Egypt. And the Egyptians have enforced the blockade pretty much as much as the Israelis have. Now, if a new regime in Egypt or a private regime comes to power, which is more sympathetic than the Palestinians, they may not agree to enforce this blockade in the same way, which could lead to a strengthening of Hamas, which means that the Israelis, if they figured they need to talk, they would be in a weaker position than they were before.
Yes.
So you can never be completely sure that things are going to be on your side.
Jen has a question, and thank you, Jen, for the question, and then to do what in class. Given Mubarak's age, what comes next has to have been on people's mind even before the demonstrations began. It has been the popular wisdom as to who would eventually succeed Mubarak.
Do you want to take that one? I know Egypt expert. I really.
You are today.
But I do follow things closely, and I'm sure anyone else who's been reading about this and watching the news, not just in the past week, but before that too, knows that there's pretty much only one organized opposition force in Egypt that has some kind of claim to power, and that is the Muslim Brotherhood. The Mubarak regime has pretty much done away with all the organized parties. I understand that the support that the Muslim Brotherhood has is limited. I mean, it's substantial, 20 to 30% of people estimate.
I think that's the number that they have in the parliament in 2005, was it?
They haven't been allowed to run the election. So they're organized, and obviously they, I think it makes sense that they would make some claim power. I don't know if there are any personalities.
Back to your comfort zone. I understand where you're going. But Jen, we'll talk more about that the next time. Maybe when we have an Egyptian guest. You mentioned about these opportunities that Israel has fought to the advantage of, and they thought that time is on their, was on their side. But again, before we move to the Palestinian document, I always wonder about the Israel internal society, the left, the organization that have, we used to hear so much about them. Why is it in recent years, but maybe since the last 5 or 6 years, the left has not done, has not been that successful in pressing the case for peace or a way of protecting Israeli interests much more than it has what we've seen?
Well, that's an excellent question. I think that the decline of what we consider the left in Israel, I mean, there are different standards in different countries. Even the left in Israel still thinks that one ethnic group has a superior rights to others, namely Jews, of course. I don't know if they would be considered left here, but in Israel, they are in the political spectrum, so I would include in that the Labor Party and Meretz, which is farther to the left of the spectrum than the Labor Party, and in fact, we used to be part of it. Their decline started easily 15, 20 years ago. It accelerated after about 2000, and I think they are responsible for their demise. There isn't that much difference as far as domestic politics between the Likud and the Labor Party, which at some point used to be, but at some point, certainly in the 1970s and 80s, they both became sort of neoliberal kinds of parties. They wanted less welfare, less of the socialist flavor that Israel had. Certainly the right wing wanted that, but even the Labor Party. Well, the great achievement that Labor had was the 1993 agreement, also, of course, with the Palestinians, which could have led to a final sort of settlement of the conflict between Israelis and Palestinians. This is something that they could claim for their own, and it was an easy thing to make because the right wing was opposed to it. As we know, things started to unravel in the late 1990s, and in 2000, basically, the final nail in the coffin of this agreement was put by the head of the Labor Party, Ehud Barak, who claimed that, he offered, he made this generous offer, they call it, to Palestinians. Yes, if I turned it down and turned to violence instead, and that proved the Palestinians were not prepared to reach a reasonable agreement with Israel, or even a generous one Israel's willing to offer. If that was true, and over time, he didn't back away from this position, became the official position of the party, why should anyone support Labor? In fact, if anything, Labor were the ones who got Israel into trouble by making any kinds of concessions to Palestinians. The implementation began of the Oslo Accords, and there was a natural turn to the right. If you look at the number of representatives they got in the Israeli parliament, it declined every election after 2000, it even started before. So now we have, together with Meretz, only 16, and perhaps split with a few people, four people away from labor, and basically join the current government, which reduced the number of people in labor merits even further. So that's what happened to the Israeli law.
We'll come back to the small social forces in Israel, but I think it's a good transition here to talk about the Palestinian backgrounds. What we find, and I want to see your point on this, what we are hearing with this in this argument is that actually Palestinians have done all they can to make peace. They, in fact, the concession on the refugees and the on Jerusalem, but it's not that Israel said no. But the dominated view out of there is that, you know, Palestinians are the ones who are at war, but in fact, this document suggests otherwise. There is a video clip that I'd like to watch it for a few minutes. We watch that when we come back, we talk more about it. Is that right?
Okay.
So we watch the video, the Palestinian papers, I think it's about 3 or 4 minutes, and then we'll get to a Yamuna's question.
That give insight into just how much Palestinian negotiators are willing to give up for a two-state solution. The Palestine Papers are the largest leak of files in the history of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. From a diary of more than a decade of talks between the Israeli government and the Palestinian Authority and the United States. The leak includes minutes of meetings, internal emails, reports and studies, notes, maps and draft agreements. Together they present an unprecedented view into Israeli-Palestinian Authority, U.S., European, and Arab relations, and reveal a wealth of information about how the parties negotiate behind closed doors. Over the next few days, Al Jazeera will reveal the contents of the papers. We begin with what's considered by many to be the most contentious issue of all, Jerusalem. This ancient city sits on the dividing line of both sides of the conflict. Both sides claim it as their capital, and is known to holy sites for both Muslims and Jews. And that's Al Jazeera's Mike Hanna reports on what Palestinian negotiators were willing to succeed.
So I heard that the Obama's team sent to Iran and over to peace process. In March last year, the U.S. Vice President arrived in the region and called for more confidence-building gestures from both sides. The Israeli response, ongoing settlement building at will on the West Bank, and an increase in the number of building projects occupied East Jerusalem, something the U.S. had repeatedly described as unlawful, the UN as illegal. And while the Palestinian Authority protested loudly, the Palestine Papers reveal its negotiators had in fact offered Israel this very same land for which the settlements were being built.
We propose that Israel access all the settlements in the city, including Mommy. This is the first time in history that we make such a decision. We refuse to do so in Camp David.
The Palestinian village of Jabal Abu Ghraib has been named Fahoma by the Israelis. It lies directly between the old city and Bethlehem, and is a natural point of access to Haram al-Sharif, or Noble Sanctuary, where the Al-Aqsa Mosque stands.
The upper hills main with the areas the Israelis are already occupying. On the table, too, this neighborhood of Sheikh Jarrah, which has been at the center of resistance to occupation.
The Palestinian Authority even committed this potentially explosive proposal to paper. This with the full knowledge that it would be vehemently rejected by the Palestinian public as a whole.
We have done our best to include the largest number of settlers.
I want to say that I'm going to like this suggestion because it does not meet our demands, and probably it wasn't easy for you to think about it, but I really appreciate it. I think we have reason to continue.
We must need a part of this for you as well. And you wish it was hard for us. We decided to give you.
Did not even these massive secret concessions guarantee the deal? Major settlement blocks like Mal Adumin cut a deep swathe into the West Bank east of Jerusalem. And in the view of the previous U.S. Secretary of State, they are immutable facts on the ground.
I don't think that any Israeli leader is going to see to Mal Adumin.
Or any Palestinian leader.
Then you won't have a state. states will be Israel had to put away some of their aspirations, like taking over Judea and Samaria.
Over the past decade, each round of negotiations has been marked either simultaneously or shortly afterwards by a massive increase in Israeli settlement activity. And yet, in a meeting with George Lucas last year, the Palestinian chief negotiator continued to press the concessions put on the table 2 years before.
Israel is on the two-state solution. They don't trust. They don't ignore the matter. Sometimes we all have Palestinians. It doesn't happen. It's the biggest church crime in Jewish history. It's a big number of refugees we do. Do it to our state. But we are coming.
And even discussed it later.
That was straight from the release document by Al Jazeera. I want to comment on
it. Get out.
What's your reaction on several issues? Generally speaking, do you find this backing as legitimate, or do you have any idea whether this would actually...
I was not present in any of the negotiations, but as in the generally speaking, people claim that these are genuine.
Yeah.
Even the Palestinian Authority people's denials ring a bit hollow, and there are some people there who will admit that these are pretty much genuine. So I'll assume that they are, as most people do. And I think the most interesting, there are five or six really interesting points that come out in these documents. Some of them were illustrated here, but the most interesting one that came up here is that it shows that the Israeli position, which is that there is no partner for discussions on the Palestinian side, this position that was first put forward by Barak and by now is accepted throughout the Israeli government, so not the whole Israeli public, but certainly Labor and Likud. Their position was that there is no partner on the Palestinian side, and this seems to quite clearly show that that's not correct. I mean, they may not agree to what the Palestinians propose, but the Palestinians apparently have been proposing way more than what anyone else thought that they would. So there clearly is more to talk to on the Palestinian side, even from the Israeli point of view.
Mm-hmm. Okay, and I want to allow the students and those who are asking questions on the internet to ask questions about what's the Israeli-Palestinian issue or any issue that you want to raise has to do with Israel, because we'd like to take advantage of Dr. Aaron's, and this is an opportunity for all of us to learn from him and to get some views on this. So if you have any questions from Egypt, can you please have them for next time? Dr. Aaron's, this is a specific issue of Jerusalem. Apparently, the Palestinians want to do some concessions there. In fact, they want beyond what was expected of them. Israel said no. What's the historical significance of Jerusalem to Israel on the one hand, and perhaps whether there is a solution to that?
So, first of all, I think we should be careful here. It's not that the Palestinians made this offer. In fact, the leadership of the Palestinian Authority made it. Admitting that they were offering anything like that before. And in fact, I think this will create, and I'm sure you agree, this has created problems for them and probably will still create problems. If it weren't for the situation in Egypt in the past week, we would have been hearing more about what the reaction of the Palestinian public inside the ethnic territories and then the diaspora is to this willingness to concede things that some people think are not really theirs to concede. I think as far as the significance, this issue of Jerusalem is really complicated. And I think it's complicated by the fact that people are messing with the facts. Even the question of what Jerusalem is something that is being distorted in order to satisfy one side's, in my view, mostly Israel's demands. So, what is the city of Jerusalem? I mean, a city is a political construct. It's not, if you go out, you can't just find it there on the ground. It's what people define as being the city. Until 1967, There was an Israeli part of Jerusalem, and there was a Jordanian. The Jordan took over what was supposed to be the Palestinian state, according to the UN partition. So there was a Jordanian part of Jerusalem, and there was an Israeli part of Jerusalem. When Israel won the 1967 war, they enlarged the city considerably by taking over a very large swath of land surrounding the part that was the city of Jerusalem in Jordanian times. In fact, it was 3 times larger than what the Jordanians considered the city of Jerusalem. The reason, we can sort of see where Jerusalem is here, but the map isn't detailed enough to see that. The reason for this was because the Israelis annexed enough territory, so, in my view, they could move Israeli Jews into the territory and make the city as a whole more Jewish. Right? If they had just kept the city the way it was, then there wouldn't have been a lot of these open spaces that they could populate. Also, there is, if someone goes to the web and finds the map of the city now, then they also extended it far to the north in order to include an airport that happened to be outside the city of Jerusalem. Just a little detail. So, Israel created a city that wasn't traditionally the city of Jerusalem. And that said, you know, this city, we can't agree to divide anymore, right? We can't have walls like there used to be until 1967. There was a wall that ran through. They said, you know, can't do it. It's like the Berlin Wall, terrible thing. We can't allow walls. Well, of course, now they actually do have this wall that separates the parts that Israel wants from parts that may not be as interested in. It actually runs through the municipal borders of Jerusalem the way Israel defines them. So there are parts of the city that are on the other side of the wall. In fact, there is a wall now. The Israelis have now forgotten that fact. So, you know, it's possible to divide the city. It's possible to divide it with a wall. The Israelis do it. It's possible to divide it without a wall if things are peaceful enough. It's just a political construct, not, you know, an objective reality.
We see that the United States position in Jerusalem has been sort of, you know, Congress has been constantly pushing to make Israel, Jerusalem as the capital of Israel. And it's more sort of the incentive to the president to come and say no, or they use the executive order. Do you think that the shift in Israel, the Congress and the president see Jerusalem as the capital of Israel? Or?
Well, it's actually even more complicated than you just presented it. In the 1947 partition resolution, which was voted on by the UN, the territory of mandatory Palestine, the Palestine that was occupied by the British after World War I, excluding the East Bank, that is the country of Jordan today, was divided into 3 parts. There was the Jewish, that was going to be the Jewish part, the Arab part, and there was an international part, which included, well, they started Jerusalem, but in fact, that included also Bethlehem and some other areas around it. Now, Israel and Jordan divided the city between them, and there never was an international part. However, that was contrary to the partition resolution, and so pretty much no countries recognized this partition. So, as far as the U.S. is concerned, not Jerusalem is Israeli territory, even. Not only is it not the capital of Israel, it's not Israeli territory. I happen to know that my daughter was born in Jerusalem, and she's, you know, she got an American passport. He just said Jerusalem as the country of birth, not Israel. She was born in 1971, so certainly Israel considered Jerusalem. And now they'll allow American citizens who were born there to choose to write Israel in it if they want to. But officially, the U.S. does not recognize even West Jerusalem as Israel. And so, what Congress has done is to move the American embassy to Jerusalem, sort of, I guess, implicitly recognizing it as the capital of Israel. This is problematic because, by international law, it's not part of Israel at all.
Speaking of international law, there has been a move, or the international opposition has always been. To make, or, you know, initially in 1947, to make Jerusalem an international city.
there was a city that were all religions were part of it. That move has never been pushed. Why is it that the United Nations, for example, I just want to see your take, why we don't push for that kind of move that would make it sort of, you know, a city for all religions to be part of it?
Well, again, you know, a city is a political construct. So, the reason that I imagine the UN decided to make it international, it drew some boundaries and it included Bethlehem because of, those boundaries included very important places to, three of the world's major religions. It turned out that, the place was governed reasonably well, not perfectly, certainly. When it was divided between Israel and Jordan, I don't think anyone is talking about making the whole area, international now. At most, and that's one of the concessions that the Palestinians made, the Temple Mount or Haram al-Sharif, the area that holds the places holy to Islam, and by the Jewish tradition includes where the Second Temple was located. They're talking about having that governed, or at least the Palestinian negotiators offered to have that governed by some kind of international body, at least for a temporary period. So this idea is still there, but the boundaries of which part there's a reason to make international the changing.
Okay. Well, we have a phone call. Let's take the call. Who is this? Hello? Jack from North Hollywood. Welcome to the program, Jack.
Hello.
Hi.
Hi. My question is regarding the percentage of Americans who are pro-Israel. What the trend of change has occurred over the recent history, and what do you see as happening in the next few years of pro-Israel land?
Thank you very much, Hank. Please keep watching.
So, there are people who keep track of the polls of these things. But I think the most interesting change that we've seen, and I started noticing it clearly during the Israeli attack on Gaza in 2006. Although signs of it were present before, in 2008, signs of it were present before, is that the wing of the Democratic Party has become very critical of Israel. That includes a lot of younger voters, includes many Jews as well. So if you look at, you can see this easily on websites that, in my opinion, cater to this demographic, right? So like Huffington Post or Daily Cross, right? These are news sites where in 2008 and 2016, you can't find an article that supports the Israeli position. I mean, when they write about the conflict, they are critical of Israel. And you didn't find that in democratic circles or in respectable, quote unquote, news sites, major news sites before. And I think this is it's a very clear shift, and it appears to be continuing.
There is also the concern that Israel is sort of promoting, they want to change their image. I think they are aware that there is a serious challenge with Israel image, and they have been working on that. Does that also relate to what's happening in the U.S.?
It's in the U.S. that they're writing these things. I think the Israelis face a much tougher job in Europe. They're much more critical. The government is handling people.
And I think at one point they were hiring even Tony Blair, who was involved in the remake of the same image. And I think a lot of recent policies have done damage to that. Let's take the phone call and then we'll come to Korea now. Charlie, welcome to the program. Please go ahead with your question to our guest.
Yeah. Okay. My question is to Mr. Arendt.
I am not Jewish, I am not Israeli, I am not Muslim, I am a Christian Catholic. And I studied the Bible since I was a little boy. In the Bible, it's written in the Old Testament, Jerusalem 400 times. My grandfather was very religious, and he used to study the Bible every Sunday, and he has to go with him to the church. I would ask Mr. Arendt, does he have any knowledge as an Israeli or as a Jew that there's no city in the world that is divided? If they want to divide Israel, in the Quran, there is no mention one time Jerusalem, and in the Torah is mentioned 400 times. Let Mr. Arendt answer on that question.
There are several answers that one can give to different aspects of this question. Number one, I don't think using religious scriptures as a basis for settling modern political disputes is a fruitful way to go, because people who adhere to different scriptures will not agree on the interpretation. The second is that, as I said, Jerusalem is a political, modern political construct. I mean, Jerusalem was mentioned is not the municipal borders that the state of Israel was settled on in 1968 when it formally annexed the city. It's something else. So, you know, we have to define what it is that we're talking about. But you put these two things together, and I think that this is relevant to the political settlement. It's not relevant to the fact that it makes the city important to certain people, right? And you also have to take their, you know, feelings into account. The importance of the city to people's feelings is true for all the people who are out here.
Let's take Corina's question. Corina, thank you so much for your question. If negotiations were to succeed, who do you anticipate that would lose the most at the end of the compromise, Israel or Palestine? This is North Korea.
Mm-hmm. If you look at these past papers that Al Jazeera made public, it seems quite clear that the Palestinians are going to be losing. I mean, they've made concessions there, or at least offered concessions. The leadership, again, we have to distinguish between what the Palestinian people want and what the people talking to Israel are going to concede. But the leadership of the Palestinian Authority has made concessions that go way beyond what people thought that they were willing to make. Even that isn't acceptable to Israel, at least in those negotiations. So it seems that, as a pragmatic matter, the Palestinians are going to be the big loser. It's not surprising, given the, you know, the balance of power between the two parties.
Yanuna, thank you so much for another question. This one is the following. Why does Jerusalem have to be divided into areas based on religious lines? Why can't it be its own state?
It doesn't have to be divided. I don't think it does. I think it's an issue of, you know, people agreeing to some kind of, you know, situation on the ground that would satisfy the desires of all the people living there. I think it's quite clear that non-Jewish citizens of Israel, mostly Palestinian, have not had an easy time in the state of Israel. They are not viewed as equal by the majority of Israeli citizens or by the government. And so I can see why, you know, the non-Jewish or Palestinian people living in the area that is defined as Jerusalem now, would not want to be part of the state of Israel. I think that makes perfect sense. I can also see how Jews here might not want to be part of the Palestinian state, certainly after what they've done to Palestinians, or what relationships have been, the relationship has been like for a long time. They would want to, you know, govern themselves, or at least not be governed by a majority of Palestinians here. You know, in the long run, I don't see why. I don't think this is a good way to do things, but in the short run, I can see why people want to split. Now, there are other considerations, like, you know, do we want to reward Israel for doing things that are contrary to international law by moving its citizens in there or not. I mean, should we just view this pragmatically as apparently, companies are rice stars in these negotiations where, hey, you know, the Israelis are there, so that's it, right? Whether right or wrong, or should we remove these Israeli settlers because it would set a bad precedent to leave there? I'll leave these things to the negotiators to figure out. Mm-hmm. But,
It's of two good things. I think it's a good link to the issue of settlements. You mentioned that. I think in May 2005, Bush wrote this letter to his Israeli prime minister, I think it was Ariel Sharon, in which he said that he's aware of the natural growth of the settlements and would not expect Israel to go back to its natural borders, and as it's 1967 agreement. And how do you assess the United States' position on the settlements? When President Obama comes and puts all this pressure on Israel to stop the fees, how genuine is that policy, and how much sure it is effective in the negotiations process?
Well, the U.S. position on settlements has evolved, so to say. It certainly has changed over the years. The Geneva Convention would seem to make them illegal. That's the interpretation that most countries in the world have, and the UN has, that it's illegal for an occupying power to move its citizens into the areas that are occupied. And it's quite clear that Israel is moving its citizens into areas that are occupied. Even right after the 1967 war, people within the Israeli government agreed with that interpretation. After that, successive governments have moved more and more citizens into these areas as ways to prevent them from being taken away from the state of Israel at a later point. That was when there were negotiations with Palestinians or whoever the other party was going to be. Some Israeli governments were hoping it would be Jordan, Palestine. They've been successful in this sense. Now, the U.S. position has evolved, as I said, where they started out with not accepting the legality of these, and then moved to other phrases like they're unhelpful. That's usually the way it is described right now. There have been American presidents who basically accepted the fact that in a settlement, it may be helpful, but when there's a settlement in the area, these, the settlers will remain in that territory, somehow it will be divided. Most recently, in the roadmap, the Israelis actually agreed to stop expanding settlements entirely everywhere, including in Jerusalem, and we're going to dismantle certain settlements that are unauthorized, even according to Israeli law. But they actually have not done that. I think the final part of your question was whether I think Obama was genuine in his effort to stop the growth of settlements. I think he was. I think it made perfect sense. It's in accord with the roadmap. It does make it very difficult for Palestinians to continue negotiating with Israel because it seems like the pattern that they're trying to make is shrinking as time passes. But obviously, we see he wasn't successful in Israel. It's just so young.
Let's take the last question from Lily, and very briefly, because we only have a minute or so to conclude. Can you please tell us a little about the American-Israeli Public Affairs Committee? How far does their power go? It seems to me it's endless.
It's a huge question. We have people who wrote books on this, right? Walton Mersheimer's book is very famous. You can go read it. I think saying that it's endless is an exaggeration, but it's certainly very powerful. It includes many people who are willing to direct their donations or direct the donations to people they support, to those who oppose people that they oppose, or to withdraw their donations from people who make some kind of mistake. As I said earlier, I think we're seeing a trend, though, in even part of the Jewish community in the U.S., certainly in the broader liberal community in the U.S., away from support from Israel. And personally, I hope that that trend continues on. I think it is.
I'm pretty well leaving there on that positive note. It's at least we have some positive and not there about what's happened in the Middle East. We come to the end of our program, and I wish we had more time. Probably we will do that with Dr. Adams. Until next week, please keep studying and keep watching. It's been a pleasure having you here, Dr. Adams.
Thank you.
Yeah, it was easy. Thank you.